Okay, so I'm Stephen Phillips. I'm the grumpy one at the back that shot his hand up, outraged, and then looked up, out of body experience, and oh my goodness, my hand's up. Why did I do that? So, there's two things to start with. There's a graph behind me, and there's me on the front of the stage. Now, why did I get involved in sales? First of all, you have judged me because I'm in a trendy three-piece suit, I've got my sleeves rolled up, and I'm wearing Doctor Who-y typey wannabe trainers. So you've judged me instantly. And then there's a graph behind me that you're saying, well, he must be a biologist because he's joined the dots. When I walk into the classroom, if I did this in the classroom, and we learnt this morning about maintaining curiosity, I would say that in this room, that's not very curious behaviour that you've just done of me. If I walk like this into my classroom, the kids would say, sir, why have you got trainers on? Oh, you've had a shave today. Oh, where are your cool cufflinks? Oh, you're not wearing a tie, so I feel proud. They would interact with me. They'd be curious as to why all these things have happened. I let you into a little secret. I cycled to school, and it didn't dawn on me yesterday that I would need to bring my clothes home if I was going to wear them up to King. So this is what I had at home left. However, if they saw the graph, they would wait for me to tell them what it meant. And so that's a big difference. I've had the privilege of moving schools mid-sales. So I've actually got a sort of a case study from the two schools. Some of that's very, very good, and some of that's a little bit frustrating, and it involves a lot of effort on the part of the teacher. But ultimately, we've got a number of things that sales and the opportunity of thinking about how to assess inquiry, what you can do with it. I think, or I hoped as a sort of getting part of it, I don't know how. I started in a selective school. How do you challenge a student that is going to get an A star, probably even if you fell asleep at the front of the room for 2 years? So how are you going to, obviously I never told the head teacher that, how are you going to demonstrate and develop and understand that real science that was such a sort of sore point for us all? Then, how do you change as a teacher? How can you change? Is it really difficult? Is it impossible? Is it really easy? And then, now, at a comprehensive school, is can you use inquiry to actually challenge the weakest students to help them make progress, help them access science in a way that they have switched themselves off to science? So, the first one, school, I think it's very important. I'll ask the same questions, or put the same questions up each time. It's a selective school, very high achieving. It's all boys, a single sex. They all do physics, much to biology's disappointment. And I was head of department. So, you come up to King's and you think, yes, I'm going to King's. I'm going to tell everyone I'm at King's, because that will obviously make them think I'm very, very clever. And you sit down and go, right, so what's inquiry? And then 6 months later, you wake up from this horrible nightmare that actually it turns out that everyone has their own definition of what inquiry is. And you wrestle with the problem, you spend a lot of time in meetings and the first year of sales just going, so what is inquiry? We hadn't even thought about how you assess it, because that is real tears. So that's where we start from. Then you think, well, what is assessment? What am I assessing? And it starts to get a little bit too much. So then, Chris sits you down, or whoever knows about it, or you when you go back to your classrooms next week, you go, okay, I'm going to pick something, and I'm going to do it in an inquiry style. And then, of course, you have the convincing others to give it a go. So, what is an inquiry? A question you can ask yourself is, well, to what content do they already know? Because you can do an inquiry at the end of the content. So in actual fact, one of the first things we did is we just happened to finish teaching photosynthesis to the year nine. So it's GCSE photosynthesis. And we said, oh, well, we've already taught them about this. How can you do inquiry on that? Well, what we set up in the classroom was prove that the last 2 weeks is right. And so the first thing we did, very able boys, and we said to them, all right, your challenge is to prove that what's in your books is correct. And suddenly all this fear comes in. So, well, how do I do that? What do I do? What do I do? He said, okay, well, first of all, we're going to need a question. And that's how we went about it. We just started in baby steps. The other thing is, you're in charge. That's what came out, in the second year, in the lead up to the Dublin conference, was actually, you're in charge. You can go away from here and you can put inquiry anywhere about anything at any point, and you choose. So it was our choice to think about assessing group work. So we took an opinion poll of how group work was done, how good students thought they were at group work, and we used resources, that's what they're called. We used some resources that Brian gave us in order to monitor group work, and that's what we investigated. We also, before we started everything, asked the boys what they thought about certain topics. But in something like this liberating moment, I'm not in charge of what's on the test, I'm not in charge of what's in the curriculum, but I'm in charge, in control, of thinking, what do my students need most? I said we chose photosynthesis, and it went very, very well, but it was very, very interesting. Luckily for us, I think we chose to do an inquiry where we had done the content first, because it really allowed us to focus on that. And what we then started to think is, well, how do we get other people to do it? And for that, I fell back on cookie mining. Because instead of trying to convince in a meeting like this, I did a staff inset and we just did the cookie mining session. All subjects, all teachers, all subjects. And by the end of it, very willing staff, there were cookies. And we looked through it and I asked them questions and I challenged them and I wouldn't give adults the right answer. They were outraged. But actually, by the end of it, you've got English teachers going, well, actually, I think I could use this, and I could use this, and I could use this. And suddenly there's that little part of you that goes, I think I might have won a little victory here. Because they're spreading it out, and they're thinking about how it already applies. So, the idea here is that we're trying to grow the students to think about, you know, don't be scared, because actually, there is the way in my head, but there could well be many other ways. The difficult bit for you as a teacher, I still think this is very, very difficult, is to, Katie said it, is not to close down avenues, because it's amazing how even your body language can shut down an enthusiastic child's attempt at working out a route forward. And you suddenly think about it, is I've never done that. So dropping back quickly to the photosynthesis one, someone wanted to see if concentration of sucrose affects rate of photosynthesis. Well, why not? In actual fact, in that moment, I said, I've no idea. Have a go. The context for why they wanted to do it is because we'd recently done osmosis. So they'd done a potato experiment and they'd seen it and they just wanted to see. And actually, it turns out that the rate of photosynthesis is slower in 1 mole of sucrose than 0.2 mole of sucrose. Does that mean anything? I don't know, but they created an experiment themselves looking at an aspect of science they've been doing themselves, and they got good, valid data. No group was excluded from seeing how you can assess them. No group was excluded from making the assessment. Again, you can make a rubric, you can make a learning arrow, make it with the students. You can have a conceived idea of what is good, and they can say, well, actually, it'd be better if someone was able to do this. There's no point hiding it from them. And this leads me on to the little graph, and the last bit, if you like, is that students become more resilient because they're not afraid of failure as much. I'm not saying they're totally not afraid of failing, they're just not as afraid. But they're more self-aware, because that graph is actually just some data, social science data, I won't knock it, okay? It's opinions, and it does look very interesting. And one of the things it does is it does show a shift in opinion. Same kids, same question. How comfortable are you? So initially, you had some people that weren't as comfortable as others. Others just thought, yes, I'm awesome, everything I know is brilliant. If I've done practical, my results are correct. And then afterwards, there would have been a shift. I'm not going to overrate that it was a fairly small sample, the shift isn't great. But there was a change. And the weaker ones, or the less confident ones, had moved upwards, and the more confident ones had moved down. They were thinking, actually, maybe I shouldn't be so keen on what I'm looking at. So, go through the second one to hopefully give you a push to understand why inquiry is so useful as a teaching tool, is that it actually can become part of every single lesson. You say why more, not no. You say, could you explain that, not yes. And you don't shut down their thought processes. And suddenly inquiry is in all of your lessons and all of your teaching. What do you look at in the comprehensive? I go in as cohort one teacher, it's my third year doing sales type stuff, and you just pick, you go, what do I want to look at? There's things around the room to give you all ideas, but you know what you're teaching next week, you know what data you've got, you know what experiment you've got. Hopefully we can help you today to realise that you can make simple changes to bring inquiry to your classroom. Is there any point doing it with the bottom set? Well, pick one of the inquiries that isn't a curriculum-based top content, if you like, so that there isn't a right answer that they don't understand. That's from them, that's their language. And do something that's all about the process, all about asking questions. And it's engaging, because they're trying to get chocolate out of a cookie. Or maybe they're trying to get a cookie out of the chocolate, who knows? That's up to them. Now, in this one, I am a mere mortal. I am just a class teacher. So how is it for a class teacher to move a department forward? Well, what I'm finding is it is much, much harder because you are not involved directly in the priorities of that department. Doesn't mean to say I've stopped, but it does mean to say it's just that little bit more difficult. So what do I think sales does? What do I think inquiry does? I think it brings down barriers to progress, regardless of what that progress is. The most able, who think they know it all, are challenged. And they can justify, they can evaluate, they can synthesize ideas together, and they become better learners. The weakest that think they can't achieve anything suddenly have points at which they can access. So the inquiry process attacks both of those barricades and helps to keep progress going. What you need to do, and I genuinely think this is, you have to be brave, you have to try it. Because if you're a science teacher, it's all about testing hypotheses. So you have to have a little go, even if you just dipped your toe. You don't have to do it all the time. Make sure you do it when it's appropriate, and perhaps make sure you don't go to a new school thinking inquiry's awesome, do your first lesson observation is a scientific inquiry, where the learning objectives are, doesn't mind a single float, and find out that you get improvement needed because the teacher says, yes, but they didn't know what they were looking for. And you realise, okay, that was my fault. I should have constructed that lesson a little bit better. And always think about yourself. What can you do and what can't you do? What have you always done? Is it the only way to do it? And really think about how every part of you can affect and influence how the students respond. Frequently you visit a group, and on my poster I say we use cups, red, amber, and green. Red is we can't progress unless you come over. or until you come over. Amber is, we're okay. And green is, please just leave us alone, sir, don't interrupt, we think we're onto something. Now, of course, you listen to all of them, and you get involved, as Katie said, as and when you need to, but you extract yourself so that the students have time to inquire. And ultimately, that is everything, apart from that I do want to build some evidence to help bring about change in my school. So because you've all listened so enthusiastically and politely, I need a selfie with you all. So if perhaps someone could come up on stage, and you can all come behind me. Do you want to take it? Yeah. So what we need to do is all look like we're having a fantastic time so that I can share good practice around my school. So you're doing this for me. So look at enthusiasts, want to okay? You're going to count down.
One, two.
Yeah, not three.
Oh, thank you very much.